Welcome to this continuation in the Center for Ethics series for 2016-17, War and Peacebuilding. I'm Roland Kushner, Associate Professor of Business, and one of the co-directors of this year's center program, along with Professors Brian Mello and Jack Gambino from Political Science. We're very pleased to welcome Professor Michael Kazin from Georgetown University to speak tonight on this program. Before getting to that, and I will continue with a more complete introduction of Michael Kazin, I want to alert you to a couple of programs that if you're here tonight out of interest in this, you might find interesting as well. One is on Thursday, day after tomorrow, in this room at this time at 7 o'clock, a program called New York Jews and World War I, and that has been organized by our Center for Ethics and also the Institute for Jewish Christian Understanding, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And the speaker is Professor Emeritus Gordon Goldberg of Kutztown University. These posters are up around the building, and you can find additional details there. Hi, Margo. I also very much want to present and promote the program we were supposed to have 2 weeks ago with Pete Juni. Peter Juni is a protection of civilians delegate of the International Committee of the Red Cross. You can find these posters around. He will give a presentation, more of a conversational one, next Tuesday, again a week from tonight, in Egner Chapel. And the functions of the International Committee of the Red Cross are largely to intercede between combatants in time of war on behalf of civilians. I'm compressing a very big mission into a few words. But in recent months and years, Peter Juni has served in Iraq and served in Afghanistan and in the Philippines and in Tajikistan. So while tonight's presentation is about the history of war and peace building, Pete Juni's presentation next week will very much be about the present. And so I certainly encourage you, and also to look ahead to Friday of next week when the Theater of War and Peace, part of the Theater of War, is that the correct, from New York, will be here as part of the Elvaic Conference. Apparently registration for that is requested. Brian, raise your hand. Professor Brian Mello is taking registrations via email. Late March and early April 1917, 100 years ago from right now, were very seminal moments in American history as the nation changed its policy and formally entered World War I. With this centennial upon us, part of our planning for the Center for Ethics program has been how to reflect on the war and its impact on American history, its momentous impact on American and, in fact, the world's history. In searching for an appropriate speaker, we were referred by our colleague, Professor Dan Wilson, and you'll see up there it says, God bless Wilson, right? We were referred to the Organization of American Historians, some of whose members are distinguished lecturers appearing in academic and public settings, making presentations on American history. The OAH promotes excellence in the scholarship, teaching, and presentation of American history and encourages wide discussion of historical questions and equitable treatment of all practitioners of history. There's information about the organization at oah.org, and Muhlenberg very much appreciates the support of OAH in organizing tonight's presentation. Michael Kazin is a professor in the Department of History at Georgetown University. He's an expert in U.S. politics and social movements of the 19th and 20th century. His most recent book that looks just like this, and of which there are copies available over on my right and your left, is War Against War, The American Fight for Peace, 1914 to 1918, published by Simon & Schuster. And his previous books have included American Dreamers, How the Left Changed a Nation, A Godly Hero, The Life of Williams Jennings Bryan, The Populist Persuasion, An American History, and Barons of Labor, the San Francisco Building Trades and Union Power in the Progressive Era, and with his co-author, Morris Isserman, America Divided, the Civil War of the 1960s. And all of those received nominations and some awards for best book of the various years in which they were published. Dr. Kazin has also received academic honors from the Graduate Center of CUNY, two National Endowment for the Arts for the Humanities Fellowships, Guggenheim Fellowship, a Woodrow Wilson Center for Scholars Fellowship, and he's been a distinguished lecturer in American Studies for the Fulbright Program in Japan and the Netherlands. Lest you think that Professor Kazin's focus is solely on the past, he is the current editor of Dissent magazine, a leading magazine of the American left since 1954, and he told me he's been doing that for 8 years. So he certainly has a distinguished career in letters and history and views. Professor Kazin will speak for about 50 minutes, and from the title of his talk, Should the U.S. Have Fought in World War I, you can anticipate a very vigorous analysis of the historic record, and there'll be some time afterwards for questions and conversation, and again, his books are available for sale, and I believe you'll be happy to sign them. Would you please welcome Professor Michael Kazin.
Thanks a lot for coming out on a cold and rainy night. And thanks to Professor Kushner for inviting me and making this possible. I'm going to talk mostly about the question raised here, which is, of course, an ethical and moral question, as well as a deeply historical one. In fact, I don't think you can separate ethics and morals from history, though some think it's possible. I don't really think it is, but we can talk about that, too. And I'm going to talk some about the people I wrote about in this book who were very much opposed to the United States going to war. I'll spare you the suspense of you know, sort of like I'll give away the answer right now, so you don't have to wonder what does he really think, because I'm going to make an argument, and my answer is no. The U.S. should not have entered World War I. But it's a difficult question, as most counterfactual questions are. All of you who have taken history courses know what counterfactualism means. It means things that didn't happen but might have happened. And certainly it was quite possible the United States would not have entered World War I. But the argument about whether the U.S. should have entered or not inevitably has a lot to do with what would have happened if the U.S. had not entered the war. And of course that's speculative, but nevertheless fun to speculate about. Now, every war, as we know, is a tragedy. It's a failure to resolve sharp differences of ideology and interest, to stop evil men or good men before they can impose their will on others. And the First World War was, I think, one of the most tragic wars in history. The major protagonists who fought in 1914, began to fight in August 1914 and fought until November 1918 in most cases, were prepared to fight a war, but none wanted to or expected to have to engage in anything like the long and unprecedentedly bloody one that ensued. And one indication of that is one of my favorite anecdotes about what happened right before the war began. As you probably know, if you've taken any history course, June 28th, 1914, what happened that day in Sarajevo, was most of you know, a Serbian terrorist murdered the Archduke and Archduchess of Austria-Hungary, the heir apparents to the throne of Austria-Hungary, and that touched off a very complicated set of events, which ended up by August in most of Europe being at war. And also much of the Middle East being at war as well, which is important to remember. But on the same day, June 28th, 1914, authorities in the German port city of Kiel, seen here, were hosting a gala luncheon for a group of visiting officers from the British Royal Navy, whose ships lay peacefully there at harbor, as you can see, with a dirigible, a German dirigible, sort of watching over them. The London Sunday Times wrote an article about this the next day and reported that the British commander in this German port, quote, thanked the German authorities for their, quote, splendid reception and, quote, spoke of his pleasure at renewing his acquaintances with old German naval friends. That evening, the British commander and his wife dined, quote, as the guests of the emperor on one of the Kaiser's most prized battleships, Kaiser, Emperor of Germany. The Kaiser had actually been there to meet with the British officers a couple days before. 6 weeks later, of course, all these people had become mortal enemies. And they would remain so until November 1918, at which at least 17 million people had died. The First World War, as most of you know, initiated 30 years of bloodletting on an unprecedented scale. Civil wars in the 20s and the 30s, civil war in Spain in the late 1930s, of course, World War II, beginning of the Cold War. It was World War I which I think really began this awful, bloody process. It planted the seeds for civil conflicts that continue to rage today. Witness the fate of the Sykes-Picot Treaty of 1916, the secret pact drawn up by diplomats from Britain and France that mashed together Shiites, Sunnis, and Kurds in a new nation called Iraq. And the names of battles of World War I remain symbols of some of the awful things human beings could do to one another in the course of battle. One of the most grisly of those was the Battle of the Somme, which began July 1st, 1916, didn't end until November 1916. The first day of the Battle of the Somme, 50,000 British soldiers died, by far the highest total in British military history. And 1 million, there were 1 million casualties on all sides by the time that battle ended. 1 million casualties. There had never been a toll like this in the history of warfare before. Now, historians will probably debate forever, as long as there are historians, whether the Great War could have been prevented. And I'm not going to get involved in that debate, though we can talk about it. There are people here who are historians and political scientists who know very much about the history of Europe and the history of the Middle East in this period. I think I read the other day there, in terms of total number of volumes, there are actually more books in history written about the cause of World War I than almost any other topic, thousands of them in many different languages, which shows you that, one, is really important, and two, historians don't agree at all about what the causes were. But for the United States, which is my topic as an American historian, it was definitely a war of choice, not a war of necessity. Germany neither threatened a transatlantic attack, unlike what Hitler what might have been able to do if he'd taken over Britain in 1940, 1941. Well, Woodrow Wilson and the federal government's propaganda agency, the Committee on Public Information, portrayed the Kaiser's regime, once the United States gets into the war, as a cruel autocracy. It was autocratic in some ways, but in other ways, at least partially democratic. Most importantly, the Germans could not pay for an army or raise an army without getting the okay from the elected legislature, the Reichstag, in which the largest single party was the Socialist Party. The SPD, the Socialist Party of Social Democratic Party of Germany, and it's an open question whether the Imperial Germany was morally inferior to the three empires it was fighting. The British, of course, controlled India and parts of East Asia, and parts of Africa and the Middle East. The French, who had a huge empire as well, and until March of 1917. A real autocrat, Tsar Nicholas II of Russia, who was overthrown by the March 1917 revolution, which was actually February by the old Russian calendar. Now, the U.S. entered the war, as Professor Kushner mentioned, just 100 years ago next week, April 6th, 1917. Woodrow Wilson signed the Declaration of War, which had been passed enacted by Congress in April 4th and April 5th. And it's hard to know what impact continued U.S. neutrality would have had. What would have happened if the U.S. had not entered the war? How would the history of the war have been different? How would the history of the United States have been different? Now, as I said at the beginning, this is a counterfactual question. historians, at least in grad school, taught, don't ask counterfactual questions. Only talk about what happened. But it's inevitable when you talk about a war, especially, the arguably the most important thing which happens to human beings, at least human societies, to ask that question, what might have happened? We do know the consequences of the decision of the United States to join the Allied powers in the spring of 1917. And it was it was very consequential. Arguably, it made the difference in who won the war, at least how the war turned out. The American Army was called the American Expeditionary Force, the AEF. It was commanded by a career military officer named General John Pershing. And it played a highly significant and probably decisive part in compelling the Germans to sue for peace in the fall of 1918. They were forced to accept a humiliating armistice in which the Kaiser abdicated and fled into exile in the Netherlands. Now, what turned the tide was not the actual fighting American troops did. It took a long time for American troops to be trained, for enough of them to get over to France and get into the fighting. At first, in fact, the Congress people who voted for the war didn't think that American troops, army troops, would actually have to go to fight in the battlefields of France. They thought the US Navy would be empowered to do most of the military work, which was constrained from doing, of course, when the US was a neutral. It would defend Allied ships, defend American ships, but there wouldn't be that much fighting. But very soon, British and French diplomats came to the United States and said, no, we need you over there. We need American troops. So it took almost a year for the American Army to be expanded from 220,000 troops at the beginning of the war to close to 4 million troops, about 2 million of whom ended up in the Western Front in France by the middle of 1918. But the majority of Americans who died in World War I, died in one battle. This battle is depicted here, of the Meuse-Argonne in eastern France, Meuse River, Argonne Forest. Actually, majority of Americans who died in the war died away from the battlefield, some from the Spanish influenza, which was a terrible epidemic in 1918 and 1919. But American troops still made the difference. Why? Because 2 million of them were coming into a front where on all sides the troops were exhausted. There had been mutinies in the French army in 1917. There were beginning to be mutinies in the German army in 1918. The Germans were depending on 14 and 15-year-olds to a certain degree to fight. And in 1918, the Germans undertook their final offensive. They didn't call them the final offensives, but that is in effect what they were. One of the top generals in the German high command, General Erich Ludendorff, told his fellow commanders, we have to strike now before America can throw strong forces into the scale. Poor translation from the German. That strike failed. One of the final offensive got close to Paris in 1918, the German offensive, but it didn't get there. And after the Germans were stymied, by the summer of 1918, they had nothing left, really, to fight with. So it was the prospect of all these fresh American troops coming into the battle which led the Germans to say, we have to put all we have, or almost all we have, on the Western Front into the battle, and then had nothing left afterwards. If the U.S. had not intervened, they wouldn't have to do that. The military decision would have been quite different. At home in the United States, the decision to go to war, as most of you probably know, led to the single most repressive episode in American political history. The Espionage Act of 1917, the Sedition Act of 1918, which were actually amendments to the Espionage Act, in effect made it illegal to oppose the war verbally. Opposed the draft, which had been instituted in 1917 for the first time since the Civil War, just verbally. There are records of Americans of German heritage being prosecuted and put in jail for a felony for saying, for cheering a German victory on the battlefield. Not something most Americans liked, of course, but it had not been illegal before then to cheer on an enemy. But nothing but to cheer them on, to say nice things about it. And perhaps the most famous man repressed, American repressed by the Espionage Act, was this guy, Eugene Debs, the leading socialist in America who'd run for president on the Socialist Party ticket four times. And in 1920, when he was in jail, ran again from jail. And he got actually more votes in 1920 than he got any other time he ran for president, because so many Americans thought that the Espionage and Sedition Acts had been a real mistake. Newspapers were banned from making the slightest criticisms of government policy. Pretty much every socialist newspaper was banned from the mails. Over 400 Americans were prosecuted for violating the Espionage Act or Sedition Acts. Some were put in jail, others were given very long periods of probation. And vigilantes freely assaulted people who, in their opinion, failed to echo the hyper-patriotic gospel. German was banned from being taught in Nebraska, where there were lots of Germans at the time. Famously, sauerkraut was renamed Liberty Cabbage and so on, and these are sort of fun to talk about, these kind of examples. But in fact, this was a period of great fear in the United States, because I'll talk about later, there was a very large and influential anti-war movement before the U.S. entered the war. And there was a strong feeling on the part of Woodrow Wilson, on the part of the government, appointees that he appointed, that if the anti-war voices were not silenced, that they could be influential and could hamper the war effort. So it was not an irrational repression, I don't think, even though it was horrible in its effects. By the way, one of the institutions which is formed to defend those who were put in jail for violating the Espionage and Sedition Acts was a group called the National Civil Liberties Bureau, which you probably haven't heard of unless you're a historian. But in 1920, it was renamed the American Civil Liberties Union, which I'm sure you've heard of. And so it was a very much a left-wing institution. It was led by a socialist we'll talk about a little later named Crystal Eastman and an anarchist named Roger Baldwin. So when Republicans and conservatives say the ACLU, it's really just a left-wing organization. It doesn't really believe in civil liberties. I think they're wrong about the latter, but its history, in the beginning of its history, it was very much an institution to defend people, especially people on the left, but not only people on the left, who had violated these very repressive laws. Now, what were the consequences of the victory that the United States won with its allies in 1918? Well, in part thanks to this man, Henry Cabot Lodge, they were quite disappointing. Woodrow Wilson gave a speech in late January 1917, before the U.S. enters the war, where he calls for a peace without victory. Imagine that. President of the United States saying we need a peace without victory. He said a peace, if you're conquered, you're going to resent being conquered for many, many years. And so that's a bad idea. We want a peace without victory. And then when he did decide the United States had to enter the war in April 1917, he gave a famous speech, which you probably heard some of the lines from. He said, the world must be made safe for democracy. The world must be made safe for democracy. This was a great idealistic crusade on Wilson's part. The peace treaty that was signed in Versailles, in the Palace of Versailles, by the leading the leaders of the Allies, France and Britain, and the United States and Italy, called for a League of Nations to be begun in Geneva. And the Senate, which was then, by 1919, under the control of Republicans, and this man, Henry Cabot Lodge, very close friend of Theodore Roosevelt's, who was very much in favor of going to war much earlier than the United States actually did go to war, Lodge says, as you say from the quotation, you know, we don't want to be involved in this world organization that will tie our hands, that will compel American troops to go into parts of the world and put down rebellions, put down little wars before they get bigger. That was one of the things the League of Nations Treaty, the Versailles Treaty, which set up the League of Nations, would have required. And that's something that after the war was over, Republicans and many Democrats as well didn't want. They didn't want the United States to be the policeman of the world. So what you had then was something of a mess. The United States goes into the war after almost 3 years of being neutral, and yet the United States was not as neutral as that word would connote, because American manufacturers made guns and bullets and other kinds of war material for the Allied powers. The House of Morgan, great investment house, J.P. Morgan, was the commissioning agent for the British. Every time the British bought something in the United States, J.P. Morgan got 1% of the cost of that good for being the middleman between the British and American manufacturers. So the United States was very much in the war even before Americans actually declared war. And that's really the reason why, as many of you probably know, why it came to blows finally, because German U-boats tried to stop that, those American ships and also ships from the Allies in carrying war materials across the Atlantic. And they kept going back and forth on whether they were going to target neutral ships without warning, or were going to warn them and help the passengers to come off those ships. But in the end, the Germans decided that they had to win the war quickly themselves or have the possibility of losing it. So they went back on an agreement they'd made with Woodrow Wilson. And in February 1st, 1917, the Germans said, we're going to resume unrestricted U-boat warfare. Any ship going across the Atlantic, which we think has war materials on it, we are going to at least try to torpedo. And that's finally what led the U.S. into war. The problem was that because of the lack of neutrality in fact, as opposed to in doctrine in World War I, Wilson sort of wanted to have it both ways. He wanted to be this great mediator for peace before the U.S. gets into the war. Once the U.S. gets into the war, he wants to try to have a peace which is as beneficent as possible, a peace without victory, if at all possible, as naive as that might sound. But at the same time, you know, he was already had already tilted towards going to war with Germany. One historian named John Coogan, who studied American neutrality, put it this way, I think very nicely. He said, it was the genius of Woodrow Wilson which recognized that a lasting peace must be a peace without victory. It was the tragedy of Woodrow Wilson that his own unneutrality would be a major factor in bringing about the decisive Allied victory that made a healing peace impossible. Soon after the Great War began in 1914, Wilson told the New York Times that the opportunity for peace would be greatest, quote, if no nation gets the decision by arms. Again, no peace of conquest. An unjust peace, Wilson warned in 1914, will be sure to invite future calamities. So in my opinion, Wilson was so right before he was so wrong. Now, what about the other point of view? Well, some historians, like my friend John Milton Cooper Jr., who was the greatest living biographer of Woodrow Wilson, argue that, yes, the peace didn't turn out well. No one can argue the peace turned out well. But he argued it could have turned out differently if only the United States had gotten into the war sooner and the war lasted a little bit longer. Because then, Cooper argues, then Woodrow Wilson would have had to be listened to much more by the British and the French and Italians. Then a punitive peace might have been much less punitive. Then the United States would have had more of a role in making the peace treaty. And then Americans perhaps would have been more invested in the kind of peace that Wilson wanted, which would have included the United States joining the League of Nations. Well, I think this is an interesting counterfactual, as interesting as the United States not fighting in the war at all, of course, but it has its own problems with it, and so I'm going to argue against that point of view. I think it minimizes the impact of what Wilson had already done and fails to take the desires and political needs of the Allied powers into account. Here's Woodrow Wilson on Flag Day, 1917. By the way, he inaugurated Flag Day. This was after the war began, this was a device to get Americans to all get behind the flag as a symbol of the country, to unify behind the war effort. No American soldiers had yet arrived in France in June 1914. But Wilson was already equating opposition to the war with treason. He was basically saying, anybody who is rooting in any way for any nation but the United States is un-American. No hyphenated Americans are wanted here, he said, echoing something Theodore Roosevelt had talked about many years before. So Wilson was already tilting in a repressive way. The United States was basically just in the war, and they already was getting ready for the kind of repression that would be visited on many Americans, Debs and others, in the months afterwards. And to me, seems to me far more likely that if the United States had gotten to the war sooner and fought longer, this repression would have been worse. Maybe thousands of Americans would have been prosecuted and put in jail for opposing it. More American soldiers would have died, and so the risks of opposing the war would have seemed even greater. And why would the leaders of Great Britain and France and Italy, shown this famous photo with Wilson on the edge, symbolically on the edge, why would they have mitigated their demands if the United States had done more to win the war? They extended into 1919 and perhaps into 1920. The pressure that Lloyd George, the British Prime Minister there on the far left, to Georges Clemenceau, the man sitting next to Wilson, Orlando, the Prime Minister of Italy, the man over there shaking hands with Lloyd George. The pressure on them would have been even greater, I think, to justify the sacrifice of even more of their countrymen. After all, 17 million people had died in the war, millions of Frenchmen, millions of Germans, of course, not quite a million British soldiers, but so many. And so the longer the war goes on, it seems to me the harder it would have been to bring about the kind of peace Wilson sincerely did want to bring about, a more democratic peace, a peace that would have made World War I the war to end all wars, that famous ironic phrase. Now, it's possible Wilson would have had greater sway over the peace settlement if the U.S. had entered the war really early. That is, especially after the Lusitania, this great British passenger ship, was torpedoed by a U-boat in May 1915, with over 120 Americans killed among the several thousand who were killed. Because then the war, you know, had only been going for about 7-8 months, and U.S. would have been a full-scale belligerent in the war at that point. And Theodore Roosevelt and Henry Cabot Lodge wanted the U.S. to go to war at that point. Wilson did not. This was the torpedoing of the Lusitania was a episode that, you know, for students here, I can only compare to 9/11, or for people my generation, to the assassination of John Kennedy. It was one of these events that people knew where they were when they heard about it. It was the fanciest passenger ship in the world, I think the largest one as well. It sort of replaced the Titanic, but it was a much more, it wasn't hit by an iceberg, it was hit by a torpedo. But only a small minority of Americans actually agreed that the U.S. should go to war at that point. Anti-war feeling was still very, very strong. Led in part by the kind of people I'll talk about in a few minutes, who helped to convince Americans that going to war was a bad idea, at least at that point. So that might have, you know, presented the United States with a better opportunity to put together or force on the other allies a better peace, a more just peace, but Americans didn't want to go to war that early. Cooper is certainly correct, however, that Wilson's primary motives for entering World War I were idealistic. And this goes against a point of view that some of the people who opposed the war said. They said, this is a war for big business. It's the United States loaned money to the Allies. So if the Allies lose, we won't get the money back. It was seen in sort of small populist terms as, you know, war is big business, invest your sons, was a popular slogan at the time. And so this was a view that a lot of people in the anti-war movement held, not just socialists, but others, that war was only good for the rich. The rich aren't gonna fight, but they'll send other people to fight for their, to protect their own profits. I think that's maybe true for some business people, but it's not true for Wilson. Wilson was a true idealist. He was not going, he didn't want the U.S. to go to war to protect American investments. He wanted the U.S. to go to war to protect the freedom of the seas, of course, from the U-boats, but also because he believed in his messianic way that the United States was the exceptional nation of the world, that only a peace in which the United States had a major role to play could be a just peace. As I said, I think he was quite wrong about that at every level. Now, finally, on this part of my talk, what would have happened if Germany had won World War I? Which is not a sure thing, by the way. It's just as possible, I think, if we're thinking counterfactually, to imagine that the war would have gone on for another year or two. Some of these countries might have fallen apart in revolution. Of course, Russia left the war in early 1918 under the Bolsheviks, under Lenin and Trotsky. They left the war. And Germany had, in effect, a revolution, though a more moderate one, in 1918 after the war ended. But there could have been revolutions in Italy and France and other countries as well. There was a short-lived one in Hungary, too. So Europe itself might have been thrown into revolution because so many people in all the belligerent countries in Europe were just sick of the war and wanted to get out of it way before the war ended. What would have happened if Germany had won again? This guy, who's this guy? Hitler, right. I purposely didn't put his name up there because this guy might have been remembered only as Lance Corporal of the 16th Bavarian Reserve Regiment, who fought in the Battle of the Somme, by the way, and several other battles, was wounded, and but got a couple of Iron Crosses. He was fought valiantly and was honored for his service. But if the Germans win World War I, Adolf Hitler is not able to become the Adolf Hitler that we know as one of the great tyrants of history. Because Hitler's appeal was based a lot on the idea that Germany had really not lost the war, but had surrendered. Germany was not occupied at the end of the war. It was occupied for a while, at least in the western part of Germany, after the war was over by occupation troops. But so he blamed, as some of you know, he blamed Jews and socialists for stabbing Germany in the back. The war, he said, could have kept on going longer. Germany would have won if it hadn't been for the betrayers within. And he used that idea of betrayers within to mobilize people in the National Socialist Party, was put in jail for having a putsch at a beer hall in Munich in 1923, and then wrote Mein Kampf, and the rest is terrible history. So what happened if Germany wins the war? Adolf Hitler, who knows, maybe would have gone back to art school in Vienna and tried to get in this time. He was turned down before he joined the army. Well, Germany's Socialist Party, who I mentioned was the largest party in the Reichstag, the German parliament, probably would have had an influential role in combating attempts to suppress national minorities and reigning in the militarist state. At least they would have been in there fighting to do those things. It would have been hard to repress a party which was so popular among ordinary, mostly working class Germans. The historian Niall Ferguson, professor at Harvard, has written his own counterfactual history of World War I, in part. It's called The Pity of War. And he argues in a provocative way, does Niall Ferguson. He says, the victorious Germans might have created a version of the European Union at 8 decades ahead of schedule. So you would have had Angela Merkel, you would have had Willy Brandt, you would have had perhaps moderate to center-left people running Germany. There would never have been World War II, most likely. Well, so in the end, my argument about should the U.S. eventually World War I, is the possibilities of less terrible things happening if the U.S. hadn't entered the war was, I think, great, and the possibility and what happened was quite terrible. And again, it was a war of choice. So anytime a nation fights a war of choice, I think one has to think about the consequences of that war, you know, much more seriously on a moral basis. World War II, I argue, was not a war of choice. World War II, Hitler could have gotten over to the United States. The Japanese arguably, of course, got to Hawaii as it was and could have gotten to California. So this was a real war of self-defense. At least it could very well have become a war of self-defense. That was not true of World War I. Well, let me pivot to the people I wrote about in the book, who shared my opinion, though of course they didn't, most of them see World War II. The book is about the Americans who tried to stop the nation from fighting in this war, which was by far the most destructive war in history at the time, and then endured the wrath of a government that punished them for refusing to change their minds. And it was quite a broad coalition, demographically, politically, religiously, racially, regionally. You had wealthy people, middle-class people, working-class people, recent immigrants, and immigrants from older backgrounds. You had urban and rural Americans, white and black Americans, Christian and Jewish and atheist Americans. They lived in every region of the country. They belonged to every political party, including socialists and prohibitionists. One of the 50 Congress people who voted against the war was a prohibitionist, the only prohibitionist in Congress. And he was from the well-known teetotaling, morally rigorous city of Los Angeles, which used to be described as a city of churches, by the way. Most of the anti-war activists wanted to make big changes in American society. They were what we consider progressives. If you know anything about early 20th century American history, progressivism covered a lot of different kinds of people. It wasn't, you couldn't equate it with being left-wing today, for example. But they all shared a profound revulsion against the conflict that was taking the lives of millions of soldiers and civilians in Europe and the Middle East. And they urged Wilson to stop the carnage, help stop the carnage, rather than joining one side in order to vanquish the other. And this was, and most people haven't heard about this movement, even many historians don't know the breadth of it, but in fact, it was the largest, most diverse, most sophisticated peace coalition to that point in U.S. history. Not until the movement to end the Vietnam War, half a century later, would there be as large, as influential, and as tactically adroit a campaign against U.S. intervention in another land. And there's been no movement to rival it since. So there's really only two major anti-war movements in American history: the movement against World War I, which failed; the movement against the Vietnam War, which arguably succeeded, but didn't succeed until the anti-war movement itself was in deep decline by the mid-1970s, but it certainly helped to defeat the United States' cause in Vietnam. I won't go into all the details about this movement, what they did, and how they did it. You'll have to buy the book or download it cheaply. There's a lot of websites now that copy people's books, and you can download them for $3, so I'm sure you can find out which ones they are. But just to give you a sense of the breadth of the movement, the kind of things that they did. First of all, the movement in its early days, 1914, 1915, was led by women. Those of you who know something about the so-called resistance against the Trump administration know that, you know, the first big demonstration was led by women, January 21st, right the day after the inauguration in Washington and several other cities as well. That was true of the movement against the Vietnam War, against World War I as well. Except unlike the Women's March on January 21st, men were not allowed to march on this first Women's March. It took place on Fifth Avenue in New York and involved a lot of celebrities and actresses at the time. There were about 2,000 women marching in it, but there were tens of thousands of people of both genders watching it from the sidelines. The feminist aspect of the movement was symbolized by the fact that one of the supporters of the movement, a man actually, a Canadian-born man, wrote a song called I Didn't Raise My Boy to Be a Soldier, which was the most popular song, the number one song of 1915 in the United States. Now you might say, how do you know, Professor Kazin, that this was the most popular song in 1915? Any guesses how people gauged popularity of songs at the time? A professor, he knows. He's a historian of popular music, among other things. So. How much sheet music was sold? That's how they told, because you know this music was played. There were Victrolas, but they were very primitive at the time. So you wanted to play a song, you had to buy the music or borrow it from somebody else. So 800,000 copies were sold of this one song. I won't try to sing it for you. Professor Kushner probably can. He's a great singer, but I won't ask him to. But and look all the verses of it. You can watch it on YouTube, too. I haven't got time to play it. But it was clear that if women, especially mothers, but not just mothers, if women controlled the world, wars would never happen. And this even this verse gives you this sense of things. And again, this was not just a song someone just decided to write. It was a song that was written in the context of an anti-war movement in the United States. Also, the United States was a immigrant society at the time, as much as it is now, in fact, even more than it is now. And so the leading anti-war organizations in America, the Women's Peace Party, which was formed early 1915, around the time that song came out, and the American Union Against Militarism, not a great name perhaps, but appealed to people in different languages. And this is an example of that. This is a meeting in early February 1917, after the Germans resumed unrestricted U-boat warfare, so it seemed like the possibility of US going to war was very close at this point. This was held at the Forward Building in New York City. The Forward was a Yiddish language newspaper with had a circulation of 250,000 every day. My grandfather subscribed. And you see their speeches in English, two in Yiddish, two in Russian, one in Italian, and people who spoke other languages came as well. And you see, it was also sponsored by a union, the Ladies, Waist, and Dressmakers Union, which was led by socialists and was very much opposed to going to war. Now, this was a movement which was what I call an inside-outside movement. It involved people like socialists who are not, of course, inside the arenas of power in any serious way. There were only two socialist congressmen at the time. It also had a lot of allies within Congress. Give you an idea. This was some of the leaders of the anti-war movement. One was a leading Jewish socialist born in Latvia named Morris Hillquit, a labor lawyer who ran for mayor of New York on an anti-war platform in 1917 and got almost a quarter of the vote in a four-way race. So this shows you that anti-war feeling was not dissipated by U.S. going to war. Crystal Eastman, I mentioned before, who led the New York Women's Peace Party and the American Union Against Militarism. She was a feminist organizer, a suffrage organizer, before she became an anti-war organizer. And also, as I mentioned, helped to form the group that became the ACLU. And then in Congress, two of the leaders of the anti-war coalition in Congress were very powerful people in their own parties, one Democrat and one Republican. A Democrat was a guy named Claude Kitchen from North Carolina, a segregationist, a racist, a white supremacist, but a man who's also believed that wars were a bad idea and didn't like war in part because, like a good Southern Democrat, he didn't want the central government in Washington getting much stronger because he thought it also might empower people in the states to demand rights for black people. But his major impulse was really because he thought the US would, there's no American self-interest in going to war. This guy was the majority leader of the House of Representatives and the chair of the Ways and Means Committee, the Tax Writing Committee in Congress, under a Democratic president, and he opposed Woodrow Wilson, Democratic president, every step of the way, and was one of the 50 congresspeople in the House who voted against going to war. So imagine that happening today. It's pretty unheard of. And finally, Robert La Follette, probably the best known of these four figures, who was a progressive senator from Wisconsin, very much against Jim Crow, very much in favor of women's suffrage, which Claude Kitchen was not. He worked very closely with people like Crystal Eastman. He was a leader of Midwestern progressives, mostly Republicans, some Democrats, who opposed going to war, who really had an economic analysis of the war, the one I mentioned before, that only big business wants war. Now, one thing before I conclude to emphasize about the people who opposed the war is that they were often, later on, after the war was over, called isolationists. You probably heard that term, a term that only began to be popular in the 1920s. If you look at that lovely program, you know, Google Ngram, you ever used that? You know, look at how different words, how popular they are in books from the 19th century up until about 2000. Isolationist hardly appears at all before 1920. But after that, retrospectively, people comment on World War I, say, all those people opposed the war were isolationists. They didn't want the U.S. to be involved in the world at all. They wanted to put their head in the sand. Well, this is not true for the activists, certainly. It wasn't true for Crystal Eastman, wasn't true for her close ally, Jane Addams, the famous social worker, urban reformer, sort of into everything, was also a leading opponent of the war, who led women from the Women's Peace Party to a conference at The Hague in the Netherlands, a neutral nation, in 1815, to meet with women from neutral nations to try to get have women from all over the world make peace by themselves, or at least convince the men who ran the belligerent nations to make peace. So she was no isolationist. We also have this guy, Henry Ford, not someone you usually think about as an anti-war activist. But Henry Ford hated war. He saw himself as a pacifist. He at one point said the word murderer should be emblazoned on the tunic of every soldier. Imagine that. Henry Ford, the most famous industrialist in America, probably the world at that time, the architect of the Model T, the architect of the $5 day, a celebrity, you know, beyond that of our celebrity businessman president today. At least he was before elected president. Henry Ford believed so deeply that the United States had to have a role in ending the war before the U.S. got into the war itself that he chartered a ship to take hundreds of pacifists and reporters to Europe to try to, as he put it, get the boys home by Christmas. It failed, of course, but it shows the lengths he was willing to go to act out his anti-war sentiments. Well, obviously they failed. And they failed because, as I said, Wilson in the end turned against them. Woodrow Wilson had said a lot of things favorable to the anti-war cause. And he met with a lot of these people in the White House several times. Jane Addams was kind of a regular visitor in the White House in 1915, 1916. But once Wilson decided to go to war, he said, no more of that. And he turned against these people because he thought he had changed his mind about the necessity of the U.S. going to war, so why didn't they? He was not the most tolerant human being against people who he'd once allied with, who decided they must agree that they should change their minds as well. The country's at war, no one should oppose it. But the anti-war coalition, the members of it, enjoyed a kind of redemption, though it wasn't a redemption they all would have liked, because the peace without victory didn't happen. The U.S. does not join the League of Nations, does not sign the peace treaty. And by the 1930s, during the Great Depression, most Americans, we know this from public opinion polls, which we have by the 1930s, we didn't have during World War I, had decided that the war was a bad idea. Jane Addams wins a Nobel Peace Prize in 1931, in part because not just Americans, many people in the world believe that the war, World War I, had been a mistake. One of the best piece of evidence that Americans turned against the war is the late 1930s, the US Congress passes neutrality acts to make it impossible, they believe, for the US to get involved in the war in the way the US got involved in World War I. Made it illegal for the US, for Americans to travel on the ship of a belligerent power, made it illegal for American companies to ship goods to belligerent powers if the US was not themselves part of the war. Now, this is all before World War II begins, mind you. But it was very clear from the rhetoric of Congress, very clear from public opinion polls, that most Americans thought the war had been a mistake. Well, finally, the title of my book comes from the first line of a great essay by this man. Nope, not him. the philosopher William James, the great pragmatic philosopher, called The Moral Equivalent of War. How many people have ever read that essay? Yeah. The professors mostly on this side. Moral Equivalent of War was a speech he gave in 1906. It was published in 1910, right before he died. And it's quite an essay, because in this essay, in which the first line, as you see, is the war against war, is going to be no holiday excursion or camping party, he couldn't have foreseen the horrors, the unprecedented horrors, nearly unspeakable horrors that the next century of wars would produce. But he did understand, I think, how organized killing took on the allure of selfless service for one's fellow citizens, even for humanity as a whole. James thought it was getting difficult for civilized man, as he called them, to justify war, but he understood that people went to war because this was a way of serving others. We talk about service, right? Service to the country. And this is very much the way it was thought of at the time as well. Now, James thought this was irrational. He thought wars didn't serve any useful purpose, but he understood why people continued to fight wars, and young men, and now young women, continue to sign up for the military, in which they expect to fight a war. Well, in the larger stretch of American history, I think it's interesting that America's been at war through most of our history, if you include the wars against Native Americans in the West, which I think you have to. Something like 15 or 20 years of US history since 1789, since the Constitution was ratified, US has not been at war somewhere. American soldiers have not been at war somewhere. This is quite astonishing. But which of those wars, can we argue, have really been just wars? Which of those wars had really been wars not of choice, but of necessity? The war against Mexico in the 1840s, pretty much a land grab. The war with Spain in 1898, yes, the US helped free Cuba of Spanish rule, but then, of course, the US takes the Philippines as colonies. The Korean War in the early 1950s, arguably there was a civil war going on in South Korea, though it's hard to say that it wasn't justified in retrospect to save South Korea from being ruled by a member of the Kim family, which has ruled North Korea since the beginning of that state. Afghanistan and Iraq, were they wars of necessity? The Vietnam War, was that a war of necessity? Only the Second World War, I think, stands out as an unavoidable conflict in which Americans are arguably fighting for national survival instead of just exercising a strategic or moral option. And World War II holds a special place in our memory as Americans, I think. The historian Jonathan Abel, who's an excellent historian of religion and public policy and religion and war, says World War II gave Americans a narrative of military triumph without a cautionary narrative to leaven it. Lovely phrase, I think. World War II is undisputably, from my point of view, and most Americans' point of view, the good war. And I think we still see wars through that prism. Now, James, as I said, argued that war was both popular and alluring and terrible at the same time. And I think even though he thought in 1910, before World War I began, that there was a good possibility of convincing people in the world not to make war anymore, to find some moral equivalent of war, as he put it, maybe some sort of national service. That clearly hasn't happened. The moral equivalent of war he talked about is probably more elusive now than when James explained why it was difficult and imperative. And a phrase in this great essay from 1910 that he wrote continues to be, unfortunately, quite true in many ways. He wrote in 1910, "History is a bath of blood." Only by recognizing that fact and arming ourselves with alternatives, both pragmatic alternatives and visionary alternatives, can we someday, I hope, change it. Thank you.